Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to your panel to discuss collaborating to fund bioscience, led by our moderator, Margaret Anderson.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to this panel. I'm incredibly excited about the panelists that we've gathered for you and the conversation that we'll have this morning, looking at investment in bioscience. And how do we increase investment? How do we utilize the investment? How do we incent the investment in bioscience? So we've assembled this terrific group, and my job is to stay out of the way in terms of the conversation. What I thought I would do in terms of getting a conversation going is ask a question that everyone will respond to start with. And from that question, you can give us a little bit of perspective about the work that you're doing. So very brief introductions, just so that you can orient yourself to who's speaking. On my left, Mark Traherne, who's the Chief Executive of the UK Trade Investment Life Science Division. Then we have Margaret Craig, Margaret Ann Craig, and I'm also a Margaret Ann, so that's good. CEO of Clyde Biosciences. We have John Reed, who is with Roche, and John is the Head of Pharma Research and Early Development at Roche and came from the Sanford Burnham Institute in San Diego, so we're going to ask some questions about your perspectives from those different vantage points. And then we have David Lowe, who's the Senior Vice President of Commercial Operations for Europe for Sanofi, and Steve Ford, CEO of Parkinson's UK. So what we've done here is assemble this array of perspectives about the life science, bioscience ecosystem. My job at Faster Cures, which is a center of the Milken Institute, is really to look at these different sectors in life science and try to understand how we can help everyone work together more efficiently. If you were participating with us yesterday, we had a small session also talking about investment. And one of the statistics that I used is looking at the number of diseases that exist that we currently know. So if you look at those diseases, we have 10,000 diseases that are identified, but we only have 500 treatments or very few cures. So the system really needs to work at a much quicker pace. One of those sort of levers is investment. So my opening question that I'm going to ask everyone to give us some thoughts on is, how are we doing with investment in bioscience? And if you could give us a bit of the European UK perspective. So I'll start over here. Steve, if you can talk about that from your vantage point.
Okay, I mean, I guess what people say to me, actually, it would classically be a person diagnosed with Parkinson's who would say, well, hang on, I'm going to be living with this condition for a number of years, and you're telling me that the treatment I'm going to have is 45 years old. It just deals with some of the symptoms. It has horrible side effects. It wears off over time and will be less effective. Is that the message for the future? And then you'll talk to brilliant scientists who've got a range of really interesting stuff that they think has got kind of potential. And you see kind of clinical trials failing in neurodegeneration. And so it's a real challenge, I think, for patient organizations to say, what is our role in this? How can we be strategic in this? I think in the past, our role was to fund as much research as we could and kind of hope that some of it would get to the top. And I think the issue now is to say, actually, our role has to be very different and has to be quite strategic, and it is about how we can intervene at the early stage to just change that risk-reward balance so that the companies who are saying, actually, we're not going to touch neurodegeneration because we've had our fingers burnt so many times, might start to say, actually, that's encouraging. We can now see that has been de-risked. So a whole range of initiatives that we're kind of getting into, and it's very early days, but I think this sort of changing role of patient organisations, where how can we make a strategic impact that kind of de-risks and then pulls in a lot of the kind of investment later down the process.
So one of the themes that came up in our preparatory calls is this issue of critical mass. And can you get enough of something? Can you get enough patient organizations really pushing the system? Can you get enough entrepreneurs? Can you get enough incubators going so that people are willing to endure some of the risk that's going on in this environment? Mark, I'm going to turn to you. If you can talk about that from your vantage point. You've been in your work here with the UK government, I think 2 years, you said.
That's right, yeah.
And you came out of pharma. So what are your perspectives on how we're doing with investment? And then, you know, do you see upwards in terms of where we're going in Europe, or are we going static?
Well, I think we're going upwards. I mean, I'm always an optimist, and I think things are looking better in Europe in terms of investment. So what we do at UK Trade and Investment is try and get more investment in here in the UK, but also get UK companies trading around the world, because clearly the healthcare challenge is a global challenge. So our little team brought in about £1 billion worth of investment last year into the UK by, you know, introducing mostly new companies coming here to set up and get into the UK ecosystem. But I think our sort of UK perspective is slightly a little bit different to other places in the world, in the sense that we ring-fenced our science budget last year. So we spend about £4.6 billion per annum on basic science. But also we're responsible for one of the, probably not the largest healthcare paying system in the world, the National Health Service, which is £128 billion budget. And it's a system that provides free healthcare at the point of access to all, you know, the 62 million patients in the UK. So we see it at both ends. The bit we can't do is the bit in the middle. We can do, and we can enable that, and that's bringing investment in. It's working with disease charities, and you know, my background is in neurodegenerative disease, so I hear a lot of what you're saying. I've worked in that area for many years before joining the government, and it's trying to create the environment where people say, yes, there's an investment opportunity here. We've got great basic research. We can potentially accelerate things into faster uptake into the National Health Service, so we can prove these products work. So it's de-risking, I think, what is a very risky business. And so what we've been doing in the UK as well is we have something called Innovate UK, formerly the Technology Strategy Board, and that invests in early stage businesses, SMEs, small to medium sized businesses, but that needs matched funding. And so I think one of the things we're really keen to do is work with, you know, the charitable sector, industry, academia, and the National Health Service to actually, you know, make the runway as quick and fast as possible. We can go out there sort of showing the lights where we can land the planes, but how can we make that process from, you know, idea to therapy as quick and efficient as possible? And, you know, the UK would like to play a global role. We have in our team 100 or more embassies and consulates around the world where we have somebody in life sciences who can go out there and interact, because clearly this is a global challenge and we need to share the risk with the rest of the world. And I think just recently, earlier this year, we appointed our first Minister for Life Sciences, George Freeman, who's come in. He, interestingly, has a joint appointment with the Department of Health and Department of Business, so it's a joint appointment. And he actually, his background before was from venture capital. So we have a life science business minister who is actually trying to sort of drive that whole story. And one of his big agendas is really trying to get better uptake of innovation into the National Health Service. So we're seeing it as being pretty positive here in the UK and across Europe.
So David, if you can sort of jump off from there, I think that you were also feeling a little bit optimistic about where we are in Europe with investment and with the possibilities. Can you give your vantage point from Sanofi and running the sort of European operations and what you've seen and where do you think it's going?
I would second what Mark has said. I think there is a real evolution now happening in Europe. Europe was kind of a bit slow up to start, and when you compared it to the US, there were several factors which were standing in the way, be it governance factors or cultural factors. On the governance, you had, for example, NIH playing a much stronger role in the US. Now you have the IMI initiative in Europe, so that's a pretty big endeavor in Europe, and it's giving the first results. You also had cultural aspects like professors were not being asked to help create a culture of entrepreneurship inside of the universities, encouraging youngsters to go off and do startups. That is changing as well. And so what we are observing is now you have kind of three big hubs, I would say, in Europe. One is around Cambridge, one around Munich, one around Basel, clearly in Zurich, where several startups have now been established and have become quite big. I mean, you can take an Actelion as an example, or you take a Speedl, which has gone public. And so clearly you are at the brink of a change. And this brink of change is really key, because what it will do is it will accelerate it even further. So it's not a linear development, it's probably an exponential development. And the reason I say this is that when you think about younger people being at universities or being at a big pharma thinking about, should I change my job, letting go on, you know, I take some big risk, I might bet the house. if you have only one company outside of a big pharma, then you think, okay, what's my plan B if I'm going to fail? If you have several ones, you know, you get an environment and a hub, you know that you can go from one project to the other. We were just discussing with Mark, you know, you can start changing your thinking, how you think about this job. A job is not something fixed. You're not staying for the next 40 years in a company, but you can go from one to the other. And going to biotech is like doing a project in a big pharma. In big pharma, projects can die, and so can startups. They can also go wrong. So
Margaret, if you could pick up on those themes from the vantage point that you have, and then John will go to you to give some of your perspectives. You know, Margaret, you're sort of bridging some of the worlds that have just been described in terms of government policies, raising private capital. I know you have interest in being, you know, sort of working in the U.S. as well as Europe.
So I'm CEO of a spin-out company from the University of Glasgow. So I am an academic scientist, cardiovascular physiologist. And what we do is we are designing platforms and offer services to pharma companies for drug discovery. So we're looking at the picking up cardiac toxicity far earlier in the drug discovery process, because what has been happening for a very long time is too many drugs are going into clinical trial late stage, and about 40% are failing in phase three clinical trial due to cardiac toxicity. And that is when a lot of time and a lot of money has been spent in that process. Some have gone into market and there have been issues with arrhythmias, sudden death, and the liabilities for pharma companies for that are huge. So what we have done over the past few years is I have a real world-leading team of cardiac scientists, and we've been liaising with pharma companies to look at where the real issues and the limitations of the techniques that they have. What we've done is design new technology, and we're now working with the FDA, and that technology has been chosen as a new regulatory asset to be put in place as of summer of next year. So for my university spin-out, we're only 2 years old, but we've gone there very quickly, and now I need to raise large sums of money. So I am an academic scientist, I have no business experience at all. So I need to go out there, and a university will say to me, have you got any money yet? We need a few million pounds. So that's what I'm out to look for just now. So access to finance for university spin-outs is not easy to achieve. A lot of that is due to the fact that we're missing some real business experience and advisors within universities. And I have to spend a lot of time going out there looking for people to help me along the way to put business plans together, financial plans, five-year plans. So that's quite a lot of work. So, but within some of our universities in the UK, there does exist tie-ins with some venture capitalist groups. And with the University of Glasgow, there's a tie-in with a VC group there. And initially, we started working with them, and they put a very small amount of money into the company. But along the way, we realised that the business experience was lacking and it wasn't quite working out. So we now have to look for the right people as well. It's another issue that we face, that the wrong person within a startup company can be an absolute disaster. So right now, I'm out there looking at forming business plans, getting finance into the company, and the way we're surviving, we are revenue generating just now, which is giving us a bit of a runway. But at the same point, we're also needing to bring in a large sum of finance so that we can now set up a base in the US. Most of our business will come from the US and is coming in there very quickly. So we now have to think about raising large sums of money so that we can set up that business there. So we're going through a due diligence process with investors just now. We're almost at the late stage of that. But that takes a long time, and we're 6 months in, and we should be able to do this a little bit faster so that we can grow. And I'm concerned that the opportunity could be missed if we don't get there a little bit quicker.
So I definitely want to come back to one of the themes that you raised, which is how do you get some of the business experience to permeate the academic environment? And we could also talk about that from the patient perspective. But John, I want to have you give us a few of your thoughts based on the vantage point from your work at Roche. I joked with you in the prep that when I did some of the research on, what's your story been so far, all the press is really consumed with the fact that you've gone from running marathons and triathlons in San Diego to now half marathons, which must be indicative of how busy you are, or it's harder to run up the mountains in Switzerland. So
yeah, that, plus
beyond
the fact
that,
plus the fact that I broke my ankle skiing the Alps, this sort of thing, so that also set me back a bit. But At any rate, no, thanks. Great to be here. Yeah. And you know, I think this is, you know, I'm new at Roche and new to Europe. I've been with the company about a year and a half, but I've spent time as a university professor, as a CEO of a nonprofit biomedical research institute, as a biotech entrepreneur, and now as a large pharma executive. So I've had the opportunity to see the different aspects of this ecosystem that we call biomedical research and biopharmaceuticals. And it really is an ecosystem that's mutually dependent on all those parts to be successful. And so I think it's really interesting to see some of the differences, perhaps, with the community that I spent many years in San Diego, which is a large biotech cluster, compared to at least what I've been exposed to so far in Europe. And my experience has mostly been in the Basel and Munich clusters, where we happen to have sites that report to me. I think one of the things that really strikes me is the difference in the magnitude of the involvement of philanthropy that I've seen, at least in much of Europe. You know, in the running a nonprofit medical research institute in the United States, for example, when we had technology that we thought had promise but was not yet validated to the point where we could have conversations with venture investors, the first thing we would do is think, you know, where can we find donors among our, you know, supporters who would help nurture that along with a gift? And I've seen, my impressions have been that the role of philanthropy, and the UK may be an exception, it has been far less present, and so there's not as much of that catalytic impact of philanthropy that we have enjoyed in the United States. So I was at a dinner at the Rockefeller the other night with that was put together by the with the heads of industry to talk about academia-industry collaboration, and on the academic side were example of initiatives that had been started that created platforms for collaborating with pharma, all of which were started by donors, Broad Institute at Rockefeller, et cetera. So I think that's been an interesting difference. The other thing I noticed is that, you know, in places like San Diego, we had a lot of, I don't know if you call them trade associations or what they were, but nonprofit groups that worked with new biotech CEOs and taught them the business. So they had groups like Connect, which his whole business was to help promote entrepreneurism and new company generation, a nonprofit. They had all kinds of mentoring programs, networking opportunities. They worked also on public policy issues to try to create a policy environment that was good for entrepreneurism and startups. There were groups like Biocom that did the same thing in the biotech industry. I haven't seen as much of that in Europe either, where you have these networks of entrepreneurs and investors and service providers who can help take a scientist or physician and really help turn them into a business person and help them develop a plan that's going to allow their business to thrive. So I think those have been a couple of the interesting differences that I've observed. Mm-hmm.
So based on what John was just talking about, some of the differences that he's, you know, already seen between you know, U.S., Europe, I mean, what are some of the things that you're excited about in terms of making some progress on, you know, let's pick any of them, the culture of entrepreneurialism, the, you know, this kind of aggregation of, you know, startups so that people can feel like they have a plan B if plan A doesn't work out? I mean, what are some of the things that you're witnessing right now and that you think need to be kind of pushed and fostered?
That's a really good question, and that kind of cultural issue. I think from my perspective, when you look at kind of philanthropy and patient organizations, I think there's the US, I think there's the UK, and I think there's Europe. I think UK is different from Europe in many ways. I look at, you know, we're a very large organization around Parkinson's in the UK. Very little small organizations across Europe that don't have anywhere near the same impact that we have. So I think there's some opportunities to work in a better connected way at a kind of European level. I think what I've seen, though, is that it's a lot of it has come through the work of faster cures, actually, this sense of learning from what's happening in the States and the role that patient foundations can take on, and that's been a big change for us, and so, you know, in the last 12 months I've I've recruited a research director with a pharma background, and you would think that would be a bit of a no-brainer, actually, but that appears to be quite radical in the UK. I mean, there are a number of people that have done that. We're not leading the way, but it's quite rare, I think, to have that approach. It still feels quite kind of rooted in funding academia. So I think there's some real challenges for us as patient organisations in the UK to create those kind of networks where we can learn from each other, where we can share that kind of experience, so we can develop collectively the skills that we need, the commercial skills, the IP skills that we need, the leadership skills that we need, so that we can have more impact. Because the UK is a great place to do all of this stuff. I mean, we haven't really captured fully the impact that the NHS has. The fact that, you know, today after this meeting, I can email every Parkinson's specialist and I can email 40,000 people with Parkinson's and say, how are we going to connect up to do these trials or whatever? You know, the infrastructure here is tremendous, and I think there's more that we can do to maximize that.
Other thoughts?
Yeah, I think you're dead right. I think the venture philanthropy is a huge sort of driver for good, you know, across the world. I mean, I think if we look here in the UK, we have sort of two large medical charities. There's obviously the Wellcome Trust, which is the second largest medical charity in the world, and, you know, often teams up with, you know, Bill and Melinda Gates to sort out problems like malaria. And Cancer Research UK is, you know, the largest cancer charity in the world. And I think they've done a great job in the UK. You know, in the US, I think 5% of cancer patients have been on a clinical trial. In the UK, it's 22%. Because you've got that patient advocacy and you've got a single charity focused with critical mass that works hand in glove with the networks across the NHS. I think, you know, looking at, say, Parkinson's, you know, you guys sadly don't have quite the same amount of money as, say, Michael J. Fox. Mm-hmm. And I think one of the things I might say then is, well, could European charities get together? Because one of the things that the US has is critical mass. You know, maybe sort of throwing the gauntlet back is saying, well, could the different charities across Europe get together to create the mass, to create a fund like a Michael J. Fox fund, which can then, you know, develop those disease-modifying products that your patients need.
I think that one of the things that we talk about at Faster Cures is, and, you know, we showed a slide yesterday that looked at the funding pie. If you think about this medical philanthropy, it's really a rather small little slice, and it stayed fairly static over a decent time frame. So the question to me is a little bit more of, how do we access the solutions that little slice has offered to the entire system? Because there's never going to be 10,000 disease charities. I'm not sure we would think that was a wise idea to attach themselves to every problem that exists. So what is it about the system that needs to be looking at these models? And I think, you know, one of the things that I'm hearing some commonality around is the academic environment. You know, in the U.S., for example, there is a little bit of tension that has formed around the disease foundations, ways that they're giving grants and contracts to the academics, because the NIH dollar is starting to go down. So everybody's looking at that philanthropic money and saying, well, I want that, but please make that money look the same as the NIH money. Don't put any different terms on it. Don't put any new licensing agreements. Pay the same indirect rate. And I think that it's evidence that the academic model is under extreme duress right now. So I don't know if folks want to comment on that.
I think that's an extremely good point, you know, because when I was a sort of academia, you know, I used to get a lot of research grants from charities. And you know, you hone them to build your own academic career, not because you're being selfish, but that's what you do. You're trained as a scientist. I think, you know, as you said in your group as well, is that people are looking differently. They're saying, we're not here to build the careers of academics. Obviously, that's a very good byproduct. We're here to discover cures and therapies to make the lives better. So I think I think charities and venture philanthropy can have a key role in terms of that catalyst, that translational research from basic R&D. Now, the dollars may not be as big as other sources, but I think if they can act as a catalyst, mm-hmm. and I think, you know, I don't know if you want to comment from the charitable side, but certainly, you know, Alzheimer's Research UK, you know, have recruited people like Eric Coran to come in from industry to try and look how can they take that basic research and actually convert that into something that's much closer to a therapy for the the people for whom they collect money, basically.
I mean, that's exactly what we're trying to do. And it's, I mean, money is an issue. I mean, we raise £30 million a year, and it's all voluntary donations, and we're looking to double the amount that we put into to research. But I think it's kind of what you do with that money, which is so important, and how you use that to leverage money and other sources. I mean, some good news for us recently. We put some money into a clinical trial, an asset that had been sort of really sitting there for 10 years with a lot of uncertainty around it. We put some money into making sure the clinical trial happened, bringing academia, the NHS, a biotech, a medical device provider together. And we're halfway through the clinical trial. We don't know what the outcome is, but Pfizer have bought the license to take it to phase three. And that to me is a classic situation of the role that organizations like us can play. That wouldn't have happened if we hadn't done that initial piece of work. And it wasn't just the funding, it was bringing the patient community together and bringing that kind of sense of urgency. And I think there are lots of ways in which we can do things like that to de-risk the process further down.
The key point is the sense of urgency. And you know, how do we infuse the sense of urgency that you've described throughout the system? And if our two folks from pharma companies could share, you know, what's the culture like currently inside the companies that you're working at to move faster? Because, you know, we have seen some hard times in big pharma in terms of, you know, restructuring, layoffs. I mean, we talked about job security looks very different in the pharmaceutical world right now.
I think that's always the case. There's a tremendous amount of urgency on delivering the pipeline. You know, we're... having spent life as an academic too, I mean, you basically, you know, you publish papers, you bring your grants in, and you're considered success. For us, success looks like, you know, how many products do you launch and how does that pipeline move? And so that's a tremendous amount of urgency around that. I think this role that the patient advocacy and charities can play is to really ask, what are the barriers that are preventing pharma companies like Sanofi and Roche from investing more in your favorite disease, Parkinson's, for example. We do have programs at Roche and Parkinson's, but I have to tell you, it's not without trepidation. When we looked at our phase two readout, it looked like it's going to take about 5 to 7 years to get an answer in the clinical trial. Well, we can go do cancer trials and get answers in 6 months. So that makes Parkinson's a high-risk area to go into. We're still lacking imaging agents and biomarkers that can help us to understand how disease progresses, because it progresses. The natural history is highly variable, so there's a lot of heterogeneity in the patient's outcomes, and all that means big trials and long amounts of time. So I think, you know, these are the kind of things that these agencies can do, and to really bring the patient communities together. You know, for example, if you put together 10 or 20,000 DNA specimens from patients with Parkinson's and provide that as a resource with next-gen, you know, whole genome sequencing, which we probably all be happy to help pay for, these can be enormous resources that then allow us to understand that disease heterogeneity, to understand the differences in timelines, and then allow us to enter that field more robustly with more confidence that we could actually emerge successfully.
And that's a great example of something that we're doing, actually. We've got a project here where we're working with an organization called CAMD in the States, funded by the FDA, and looking to pull together data from cohort studies, from clinical trials, the control arms of clinical trials, getting a whole number of pharma companies around the table in that kind of pre-competitive collaboration to say, how can we pull all of that data together and produce some clinical trial models that actually predict the progression of the disease, that build in dropout rates, that build in that heterogeneity. And I think the ambition from that is, if you can get those models effective, then can you reduce the actual cost of doing the clinical trial, the sample sizes needed, by 30 or 40%? And suddenly that makes a massive difference to you guys and the presentations you're making to your boards. And so, you know, that for us, you know, that could cost us £3 or 4 million to provide that kind of leadership. But I think the impact could be very significant. And I think when you can then tell those kind of stories, then you can get the philanthropists kind of involved. I think it's having the story to tell is often important. Mm-hmm. And I think part of the reason perhaps we haven't been able to pull in the money is because we haven't been telling the stories in the way that are purposeful.
I think one quick important story, though, to dovetail off what you just talked about, and you raised it as well, David, which is this advent of public-private partnerships and collaboration, the IMI, You know, we have a project at Faster Cures that we wrote a report called the Consortiapedia, where we chronicled the rise of doing research by consortia. And I think when we published the report 6 months ago, we were at maybe 360 that we had identified, and now the number's over 400. You know, now I think we're all looking at those and saying, terrific, everybody's in, we're doing pre-competitive collaboration. Regulatory agencies like EMA and FDA are you know, very involved. But now there's a sense of, all right, what are we getting out of that? What are the metrics? And so, you know, just when you sort of get one thing that you've accomplished, the next thing, you know, kind of presents itself. But that's a very vast culture change, I think, even in the last 5, you know, years. Mark, you were going to say something.
Yeah, I think, you know, and we just sort of touched on this earlier, is, you know, how can we use the NHS, which, you know, when it was founded in 1948, was, you know, founded as a research engine for, you know, and... is how can we sort of rediscover that great origin, you know, because I think you touched on then with the 100,000 genomes project, you know. Again, you know, that the government's put 100 million into that. You are now trying to find partners to sort of share the risk in that. But ultimately, it can, you know, get you your patient cohorts faster. It can select the patients. So those clinical trials become de-risked. You know, it's going back to my analogy. We need to build the ecosystem, that sort of runway with the lights. So it's much easier for you to land the products. And you don't have that risk of worrying, where are the biomarkers? You know, where are the patients? How can I select them? What are the endpoints? You know, hopefully we can build that ecosystem so it de-risks it for business. And I go back again. I think, you know, charities are a key catalyst in making that happen. I think the thing about the UK is if you look at the two big charities I mentioned, it's often old money. You know, the Wellcome Trust money and the Cancer Research have been around for a long time. I think what the US has been very good at is bringing new money, you know, like Michael J. Fox in there. And I think that's something Europe can definitely learn from. How could we get new charitable money in there, really to act as a catalyst for, you know, government money and, you know, industrial money to come in alongside that, really to sort of build this runway so we can land those products for the benefit of your patients.
But I think even groups like learning. Michael J. Fox, though, quickly, that they if you talk to them, they'll say, you know, how do you even go beyond the community that's affected by the particular disease, and how do you create momentum? And we all saw that a little bit with the ALS Ice Bucket Challenge, where you know, people kind of got captivated by this concept. I mean, so I think there's a little bit of a to-do list, and maybe, you know, you could bridge it with some of the work that you've just described at the NHS, where eventually we'll all be patients, right? Or we have patients in our lives. So how do you take a little ownership of that challenge today? You were going to say something.
Yeah, I think talking about learning, I think this is going to be key. We have seen a big evolution with patient groups in Europe, I would say, for the last 10 years. In terms of learning how to lobby, how to set agenda, how to get involved in public affairs, how to connect with IMI. And the pharma industry was helping with the London School of Economics to build up skills for patient groups. And I think I see a big evolution, even if in the press you can see it's bad if pharma gets together with patients. I would disagree with this if it's done in the right fashion. For sure, you don't want to have the pharma industry lobby for reimbursement and instrumentalize patient groups, but there can be a partnership in terms of, okay, building up skills, for example, or also providing input into how you design clinical trials, because the patients have the experience to live with the disease.
Yeah, definitely.
Well, and the other thing is benefit risk. So are we asking patients, when we're doing research, what it is that they actually want solved? And you know, there's some, I think, growing work that we're seeing in the U.S. where the FDA has been convening around different disease areas to look at that. Faster Cures has a benefit risk advisory council where we've convened a kind of cross-sector group to see, is there some sort of a guidance development process that we can assist the FDA with? I think there's real movement there, and I think there's energy that certainly pharma companies have that they want to put towards that. But it's a situation, it seems, where they don't want to go too far ahead of the regulatory bodies. So, I mean, I think what you all are hearing is this continued sort of churning where the different parties are trying to figure out how can they engage with each other. Any more thoughts on that theme in terms of the role of patients? I mean, that's another thing that we're seeing. Sanofi has a chief patient officer who, I don't think she's in the room, but she's participating in this meeting. Patient-centeredness has become... it's not just a hot topic. I think it's a business decision that everyone is realizing has to be taken seriously.
I think it's so important, Margaret. In many ways, obviously, it's important that we deliver what patients find most valuable in terms of living with their disease and experiencing improvement. But it also becomes a business issue when you discuss with the payers what endpoints actually matter. And I'll give you maybe just a good example of something going on with Roche right now. So, you know, we work in neuropsychiatry, for example. We have a promising medicine for depression, treatment-resistant depression, that we're excited about. And the nice thing about it, it's a totally new mechanism. And unlike all the other depressants that we have today, it doesn't have the metabolic problems or the sexual dysfunction problems that goes typically with antidepressants. You know, depression is one of the leading causes of disability in the world. So this is a big problem. And there hasn't been a new mechanism, a new drug delivered in 40 years with a new mechanism. Lots of sort of, you know, variations on what we already knew how to do. When the analysis was done on the European community's ability to pay for a medicine like that, it was, you know, don't expect to make any money in Europe with a medicine like that, because there are low-cost generics that we can use to treat depression. They got lots of side effects, but, oh well, I guess the patients will have to live with that because we're not going to pay a premium for that. In the U.S., on the other hand, the entire business case was on the U.S. market entirely. So it's a really interesting question to ask about that, because it not only has ramifications for what matters to the patients, which, of course, is first and foremost, but also in the eyes of the payers, in terms of, you know, what's going to reward innovation.
I mean, we make I would say, steps in the right direction now with the establishment of EU HTA net, where the payers are coming together and start to discuss what would be the right endpoints. But it's a bit the process like you had when the EMEA was established. It took several years for people to start to let go and you know, centralize it a bit more. And I think we are at the beginning. Several companies are testing it. And I think for biotech companies, it's going to be vital that this guidance becomes clear. Because when you take a treatment into the phase two already, which is typically biotechs go up to proof of concept or phase two, you need to already know what the payer is going to ask you after the phase three. So it is going to be very important that the regulators, EMEA, at least for Europe, and the payers get closer together.
So clearly that issue that you've just described around reimbursement, who will pay for this innovation, is very much in active conversation in the United States. You know, pricing has become a very hot topic. I think from the patient advocacy perspective, there's been a bit of a stepping away, saying, "Oh, you know, this is, we're not in the rooms when these discussions are being made. We don't understand how the process works." So I think that payment, reimbursement, you know, the financing model is certainly something that we're going to see a lot more discussion about. Margaret, I don't know if you want to jump in terms of, you know, the perspective from your kind of small company starting to get going. I mean, how do you view some of these issues that we've just described, you know, from the maybe the smaller perspective, smaller company?
So I suppose what we're, I think an understanding of disease models is probably really important, and academics getting involved in that at an early stage and working with pharma companies to design exactly the models and the tests that they want to see going forward is really important. For example, we've had a discussion about how pharma companies are approaching us to apply our technology to neural cells in order to create neural cells that can be used for therapies for future, to understand that the physiology works. And so, you know, we're now talking to each other about how we link up with, you know, foundations such as Parkinson's UK and pharma companies, and work together and also access finance perhaps through a patient foundation like that to make sure that we get the research there and get the cells and things like therapies ready for future.
Mm-hmm. Mark, does your work touch on this issue of reimbursement and how do we pay for innovation? You're part of a government agency, and you've got another one probably sitting next door in terms of the NHS that is having to actually pay for the therapies.
Sure, and you know, it's a big healthcare provider, and you know, we are obviously very interested in the costs of running that system. So in essence, as I mentioned earlier, our new life sciences minister, George Freeman, has a joint appointment between BIS, so that's business, innovation and skills. So we have a single department that funds universities and works on business. So it's seeing that we see universities as a growth engine for the economy. And he sort of sits across that into the Department of Health. And his role now is to really look at the uptake of innovation. And I think it's not just looking at patient benefit. Obviously, that's a, you know, a prime consideration. But it's also cost, right? Because like any healthcare system in the world, it's coming under pressure. How can we make it more efficient? And we've talked about making the you know, the drug discovery process more efficient? You know, how can we reduce attrition? You know, using smarter cells to look at cardiac safety earlier, maybe reducing that attrition so you weed out the compounds earlier in the process rather than late in the process where it's in. But I think we've got to look a lot more intelligently about how we deliver healthcare in a more efficient way. Because everything is coming under price pressure. So I think one of the things we can do in the UK is really look at that economic model. And you mentioned work with institutions like London School of Economics. We've got to look at those price models. And I don't think it's just, frankly, it's just the US and Europe teaching the rest of the world anymore. I mean, my daughter's out in Malawi at the moment, where they have very different healthcare systems and issues. And just hearing back from her on Skype and things, they've leapfrogged a lot of the issues we've got. They don't have big hospitals, they have mobile telephony. I think there's a lot we can learn from other healthcare systems. And one of the advantages is that there is no perfect model. We've just got to learn from each other. But I think we have to understand the economics. If we don't understand the economics, it's going to be quite tough for us to, wherever we are in the world, to deliver efficient healthcare.
Well, I think you bring up an important point, too, around it's no longer, you can't just look at your particular vantage point, my job is to develop new drugs and get those through the pipeline. You actually have to worry about the entire continuum of how they're being deployed. Are we doing it efficiently? Can we squeeze more money out of that system? And that's something that we look at, which is if you can't figure that out, how are you going to ever have enough money to do the innovation, which is costly? You were going to say something?
Yeah, I think this is what we have to look at now is from universities that they have to be more innovative. And from Scotland now, I'm certainly pushing government to, because we have a lot of untapped talent within universities. There's a lot of research council money being spent with there, but there's no caveats that they actually have to produce anything commercial at the end of that. So what they're looking at now is actually removing IP control from universities in Scotland, and then from Research Council money, as part of the devolution process, they would like to see a certain percentage of that has to be used for company interactions so that we get more innovative science out, and universities are having to work more with companies so that we are being more innovative and working together so that we can push things forward. And also, it means that there's more money going into companies, more innovation, more chance of jobs, more economic prosperity there from it. So it'd be great to see if the government can push that through and achieve that.
So when you show up with that message at the university door, what's the response or even from the government to say you need to push on this too?
So from the university side, I'm a little thorn in their side because I believe that we can do things better. And it's been an amazing process for me to try to build a spin-out company because it just looks far too difficult. And it surprises me that we're not good at this. And I think universities have to be better at it. And when I'm challenging them to say, we need to sort issues such as equity, IP, we have to make all of these things far easier to do. We have to get access to money easier. And these tie-ins that we have with VC groups, they have to bring the expertise because we're not getting there fast enough and achieving things well. So when it comes to universities, it's been difficult, it's been challenging, it's been painful, but hopefully we'll move it forward. Pushing the government, some don't want to rock the boat, but others are saying, no, we're willing to take this on. So, and it looks as if they're rising to the challenge now.
And from the patient perspective or disease foundation perspective, are you also feeling like you have a role to play to be nudging on these systems? I mean, when you were opening your remarks, you said, you used to just sort of give the money and say, we hope it works out. And I think, we've certainly heard that from other charities saying, we're actually looking for an ROI on the money that we're putting down.
Yeah, I mean, I'm just thinking one of our big grants, actually, we had one of the peer review meetings this year, and the academics presented what they'd done, and did some really good stuff, and the academics on the panel were sort of patting them on the back, saying this is brilliant. But we'd brought in someone from pharma, actually, and he said, hang on, if I presented this in my organisation, I wouldn't get past slide 3. And that, to me, was a really powerful statement, actually, and it's making us think, how do we bring that kind of discipline into all of this? There's a bit of tension in the system, but actually academics, I think, really welcome that and are starting to say, how can you help us get access to some of that opinion to help us so that we can present these things better and take things on. So I think that's the kind of role that we have.
Yeah.
And I think it's easier. How do you mesh, you know, curiosity-driven research with, you know, something that's sort of product or service focused? And I think if you look in other areas that are more established, like engineering, my son's doing an engineering degree, for example, it's absolutely taken and understood, and you know, it's not an issue. I think it's in life sciences. I think probably it is more challenging to get people to think about a product or a service, you know, because they historically have been incentivized to publish high quality papers in good journals. And that's a great thing, but you know, we've got to say, well, actually, there's some. And I think one of the great things, particularly in the US, which I think is a great initiative, is, you know, joint MD-PhD. You know, so people are doing basic research, but they actually see patients. I think seeing that, you know, a bit like an engineer, you know, you can actually see the product, but you understand the science. It's actually seeing that connection is absolutely key. And, I mean, and, you know, I think that's something maybe Europe could do more of, but just a personal point of view, is more MD-PhD programs. We've got people actually treating patients, but still interested in basic research and doing, you know, cutting-edge research.
As well as MBA combined degree programs. Yeah. You know, I'm aware, for example, in the United States, of a new MBA program was started right next door to a medical school, and the sort of phenotype that they look for in the students that they enroll are they're either an engineer or a scientist who wants to learn business, and they want to bring those two worlds together much more efficiently. So I think you can do a lot of innovative things like that.
I think university spin-outs are a great place for scientists to learn as well. And over the past 2 years, we have had many students, PhDs, masters, interns coming in, learning a little bit, you know, about running a business from financials, all the way through to marketing, but at the same point, learning some really good science and applying that. And that's what we need to see in future as we grow this company. The vision for the future is to continue to grow that and have students come through and learn some commercial
So, Mark,
expertise.
Actually, I was wondering, we started the conversation to Margaret's point in terms of holding the professors more accountable to, you know, encourage IPOs. When I walk through the corridors in the San Francisco University, which I recently did, you walk the corridors, you see posters, you know, from ID to IPO, course at 6 o'clock in the evening, meet venture capitalists, etc. So this fomenting of creating this environment. Who sets the incentives? Because the professors will go where the food pellets are, right? So you reward plays a role. So who is doing that? Are you, as the economies, impacting on education, or how does it work?
Well, it's a very good question, actually. And in the UK, you know, universities are sort of independent of government. You know, they're governed by Royal Charter. However, you know, a lot of the funding comes through government. And as you said, in Scotland, a lot of it is devolved. But ultimately, it's in the nation's interest to get more translational research, you know, things that are of commercial and medical benefit. But I think actually, in some ways, you know, it's actually that cultural change that you were talking about. Yes. It's actually the people that drive. And I'm very interested in the Californian experience. You know, was it because the Californian government said, you know, here are the incentives, or was it because the people in California got a real kick out of doing that? I mean, what you know, we all hold up California as the great place for entrepreneurism. Was it driven by government, or was it actually the people? You know, what's your view, or a bit of both?
I think the people and the access to capital, you know, and then eventually, you know, blossoming into an ecosystem that provides a very supportive and nurturing environment. But back to your point, Margaret Ann, I think you know, money is a great incentive to academics, and I happen to serve on, for example, the board of a program in California, which was for stem cell research, and the state of California raised $3 billion to deploy for stem cell research, $300 million a year. And a big chunk of that was in collaborative research between biotech companies and academia for initiatives designed to get things in the clinic of a range of everything from medical devices to diagnostics to cell-based therapies to traditional therapeutics. And it really worked, you know. It catalyzed a lot of academics to sort of wake up and say, you know, I need to get busy finding out what's going on and how I can participate in more applied research. And and I think that'll then live on after these after there's been that motivation to bring together those two worlds.
But so I think we Europeans need to actually think, you know, how do we break the culture. Our culture is a bit different than what we have seen in Silicon Valley, right? I mean, you had a lot of socialistic healthcare around Europe. You had the professors being rewarded and making a career out of publications, and then that's it. So I think we need to probably also a bit more with government help to drive that change.
But would you say, John, I mean, wouldn't you say the academic culture is a little bit similar, that there's an academic model where, you know, it's publish or perish, and you need your grants to keep your lab going?
Right.
So I don't know if it's that different, actually, than Europe. I think I want to go back quickly to this theme, though, this, you know, what's the kernel of innovation that exists in California, whether it exists in Cambridge and Boston. I mean, the stem cell initiative in California was started, if I'm not incorrect, by the father of a child with type 1 diabetes, who was looking at stem cell as a as a chance for therapeutic intervention. I mean, how much did the state actually understand, well, this is good for patients, but it could be really good for the ecosystem, the economy? And, you know, was there a discussion as that was being voted on to look at return on investment?
There certainly was. That was a big part of the whole pitch and sell, was the economic development piece. And the argument was to the taxpayers was, you let us float these bonds to pay for this, and we'll more than double return that in economic development to the state. So that was a big, big part of the push. It wasn't only about saving lives. It was also about economic development.
Well, and I think in the U.S., what you see and hear is there's almost a healthy competition between, you know, these hubs in California and Boston, you know, to sort of say, you know, who's got the most kind of activity going, where's, you know, who's got the best kind of return on investment. And I think the state of Massachusetts really saw that. They put their investment down, I think, $3 billion over some period of time to really get things going there. I mean, there's, I think, a very vibrant economy. Obviously, there's lots of other places in the states that are actively interested in pursuing that. So as we're moving into closing, and I want to see if there's a couple questions in the audience, I want our panelists to be thinking about, you know, what would your formula look like to get us to the future that is as vibrant as I think people want to see it? I'm going to ask the audience, though, if there's a question or two, and we have a microphone over here. Barbara?
Couple of comments. Just firstly on the stem cell piece, I co-wrote the proposal to bring the CRRM to San Francisco, and it was really interesting because we had a San Diego-San Francisco showdown, and I was, you know, co-writing the proposal and staying up late and working with Gavin Newsom to write that. But when I went out for coffee, people who knew nothing about biotech were talking about it in the city, in San Francisco. It was like game day, right? It was a Giants game. We're going to crush San Diego. We're going to bring it to San Francisco. And I'm like listening to this and turning around, and I'm like, wow, you know about stem cells? They're like, stem cells? No, we have no idea, right? And the same thing happened with the ALS Ice Bucket Challenge, right, where people got on something through Facebook, and they're like, this is really fun, we can engage with it. Did they actually know anything about ALS? Probably not. Did they donate? I think maybe half of them did. But it didn't matter, right? They thought, oh, I'm going to throw an ice bucket over my friend's head. That's cool. That's fun. And I can do it through Facebook, right? So I think there are entirely new ways that we need to think about raising money that are happening right now. They're not things that we need to discuss that might happen in the future. They're happening right now, and we need to understand the new way of thinking, communicating, sending messages. I work with Global Genes, a rare disease company, and I'll tell you that that community, the rare disease community, are so educated on the science and so connected through social media, and so connected with FDA, NIH, any piece of science that's happening in academia, they know about it before any company does. They're also sitting down with the companies and talking about whether you can do the clinical trial this way or this way. Should it be a placebo trial? The FDA says it has to be. We'll go to the FDA and say, well, can we really do that with kids with a rare disease? They're looking at compassionate use. If they really want compassionate use, they're going to go on Facebook again, right, and demand it. So there are whole new things that are happening right now that we need to be aware of in the room. It's not about what's going to happen tomorrow. It's already happening.
So if you want legislation written, Barbara's your person, right? Mm-hmm. And
absolutely.
She's a citizen of the world. Absolutely. Yeah. So over here, we're going to go to the other side of the room just to take a... Are you going to be a contrarian again?
I'm going to just get some kind of perspective here, okay? Yeah. So I think everybody in this room knows that in the last 7 years, probably out of necessity, things have changed. It's become more cohesive. We've better understood core competencies. We've put all these together. The emergence of patient groups, hugely important. New sources of capital. All that's fine. However, if we look at biotech products over the last 10 years, it's flat. Now, those indices are held up. Whichever indices you look at, being outperforming any other indices, any other industry. Not quite sure about that. Let's take out orphan diseases and cancer, which you alluded to, John. I'm not going near CNS because that's, you know, as a company, not just Roche, anybody. I'm going to cancer because, let's face it, the hurdles are slightly lower. So my question to all of you is that what I'm hearing in these meetings continuously is that we are still fundamentally pushing up. We're doing things faster. We're doing things in more cohesive fashion. But really, we're not looking at, collectively, what can we do with the money that we raise? Maybe we raise more, but we actually collectively use it and look down to solve a problem. Nobody's touching on that. That's the big issue to me. Nobody's actually looking at the guy, the gentleman made this point yesterday in the meeting about, you know, trying to do a clinical trial in you know, kind of anything in CNS, anything, basically. It's much longer. So, you know, he needs the patent system to change. So, you know, kind of, we keep talking about the early stage and moving that and what we're doing and how better it is, but we're not really thinking about it strategically from the top with the money that we have and directly targeting serious issues.
Well, but is it also a case that we don't have a czar for fixing the system? I mean, let's use that as a closing opportunity to kind of, you know, hit on the points that were just raised, and I'll start down here.
Sure, I think there were two points. I mean, one is, you know, you've got to look at the whole supply chain and economic life cycle, which if you don't do that, it's quite tough. If you just look at each little silo, it's going to be harder. So one of the things we're doing in the UK is to look at this. We've got a Minister for Life Sciences, you know, who can actually start to bring all those different bits together and actually look at the whole supply chain.
NHS, is that not a big plus, the fact that we do have that?
Absolutely, it's a huge plus, you know, and again, we see it as an engine for growth and economic growth and a huge opportunity to engage with patients, 62 million patients, many of whom will be, you know, cross over with your patient subgroups.
Yep.
Steve's being very, very. Steve is one of the leaders in the charities in trying to look at different models, and we're seeing significant changes with charities coming together to actually do things differently. The problem is it's going to take time, but I really think there's an impetus there, and I think we're being too pessimistic on it.
Okay,
and on the second thing about the what's going to change. Academic to change their thinking to look is, I mean, we should talk about the impact agenda and what the government's done on there, where the REF is yeah, focusing sure. people on looking for impact for your research, and that's going to change behaviours, and I think you're going to see a greater emphasis on translation going
totally
forward.
Agree.
Okay, Steve, go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's it is about how we can develop that the role of patient groups. Actually, I think, you know, this is very stimulating, these kind of discussions, and we need to be having more of these with patient organizations sitting around the table and injecting that urgency and driving the kind of process, and you know, there's more work that we need to do to get to that position, but it's a process that's
can't
started.
Say no to the EMA. Go ahead.
So in response to this gentleman who is a bit of a pessimist, I'm also an optimist. Look, there is change, and it hasn't been discussed in this group. If you want to bring products to market, you need two things. One is product research, but the other is tools research. I'll give you an example, and this is now changing dramatically, the recognition that you need tools to do science to bring products to market. So 10 years ago, if a big company had a product in COPD and they needed as a patient-reported outcome, they would think this is competitive, we do this on our own. The attitude has totally changed. This is now more in the pre-competitive space, and the shift between sort of the boundary between what is competitive and pre-competitive is greatly shifting. So to give an example to your case, Parkinson's, you said it's so risky because it takes 6 years to read out. Go to Alzheimer's, it will in future be 15 to 20 years. Go to polycystic kidney diseases, it will be 30 to 40 years. So what we need is tools to predict biomarkers, whatever. And this is why you're now seeing your, what do you call it, consortiopedia that will grow. And that will continue to grow because there is this shift. So isn't that the role for patients really to be in, to push for that? Not the individual product, but pushing for the tools development. And then also the second role that I would see for patients and patient charities, what you rightly pointed out, there is one organization, say, called for example, the EMA, that says, we want to look at a drug by measuring this. There is a payer in Europe who wants to see that, and a second payer who wants to see that. Where are the patients to say, look, guys, this is we call the shots. This is what we want to see in a new treatment. And this is what you decision makers take into account. So I think there, we expect more from the patients, more initiative, more activity, more funding of this tool research.
Thank you. So Margaret,
yeah, I think
quickly.
When it comes to tools, having better tools for predictive to predict diseases is exactly right. Now, looking at stem cell research, the models that are coming through now I do have the biomarkers for late stage sort of Alzheimer's disease, and those are tools that we have to now use and implement to test therapies now for future. So that is moving forward. A lot of work in Japan going on there and producing good models from that, and that's what we want to use going forward.
John, and then David.
Well, I think we've had a lot of good discussion on the points, but I would emphasize that, you know, this is really an ecosystem with multiple dependent parts, and you know, we need to understand that and try to do everything we can from a policy, from an investment standpoint, et cetera, to make all those parts work and work together. You know, the pharma industry, which ultimately does most of the commercialization and distribution of the medicines, manufacturing, et cetera, is entirely dependent on the good basic research that comes out of universities. Mm-hmm. That then translated typically by biotechs, you know, it's a feeding chain. And along the way, there are issues around how do we incentivize philanthropy to help catalyze some of those early steps? How do we create tax structures that don't disincentivize entrepreneurism? We've talked about some of the predatory tax environments that, you know, make it, I think, probably greatly disincentivize scientists wanting to become entrepreneurs, particularly that in some parts of Europe. You know, how do we get the regulatory piece coupled with the patent piece, as we just talked about? It all has to come together, and I think, you know, Faster Cures has done a good job of helping identify where those roadblocks are and trying to get the different stakeholders all part around the table of having those discussions. So we wish you continued success in what you're doing there, Margaret.
David?
So I'm also much more optimistic than you are. I think, you know, to take this off in terms of more an exponential development, you need to have fixed many things. And I think we are getting there to having fixed most of them. I mean, we have the EMEA, we have EUHDA.net, we have patient groups knowing now better how to deal and raise money. We have more entrepreneurship developing in hubs like Cambridge, Munich, Basel. So I think it's now getting to a phase where if you're a venture capitalist or a bank, or you're thinking about, okay, where do you invest, you can have a first mover advantage by starting to get in there, I think, more aggressively now.
All right. I'm going to let you finish
That's
the conversation
why we have the meeting
after
today.
We're done, or I'm going to get some heat for not clearing the room. So I want to thank our panelists for this really tantalizing conversation. Please join us at Faster Cures in a lot of the work that we're doing that covers these issues, and check out some of the resources that we have on our website. Thank you, everybody, and thanks, panelists.
Thank you to our panelists.